Desk of Lady Ada.
Hey, everybody, and welcome to A Desk of Lady Ada. Took a little bit of a summer break, but we're... break time is over now.
Yeah, break time.
Break time is
over. We just had a show, like, 2 days ago.
Well, you know, I didn't do A Desk of Lady Ada, though, for a while.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
We had a desk near Ask an Engineer.
Yes. But doing electronics, been very busy, also taking some time off. But today I got an awesome thing in the mail. I thought everybody watching the show would be really into checking it out. I got the Essential Guide to Electronics in Shenzhen by Andrew Bunny Huang. And this is a book that I backed on Indiegogo. Not sorry, Indiegogo. Crowd Supply. Sorry.
I'm sure they get that.
Edit that in post. From
Crowd Supply. Live. There's no editing.
I've actually been following the process as he's been getting this book printed. It's a book designed for electrical engineers who want to go to China, especially to Shenzhen, and check out the SEG markets and the other markets there, and buy electronics and meet the representatives of manufacturers and distributors in Shenzhen. It's an electronic wonderland. So, do you want to start by maybe playing the video that he made for his backers?
Yeah, on Crowd Supply, Bunny made a video, and we're going to play it, and then we can do a little bit of tour of the site, and of course, a tour of the book. So let's kick this off, Lady Ada.
Shiny.
Here we go.
Yeah.
Shenzhen is an amazing place. It's really the center of the hardware and manufacturing universe right now. I spend a lot of time there sourcing components for my own projects. I've also introduced a lot of people to Shenzhen. For a lot of people, their first trip can be intimidating, but it's actually quite manageable if you're armed with the right information. That's why I created the Essential Guide to Electronics in Shenzhen. I wrote the guide specifically to help non-Mandarin speakers navigate the electronics markets. The book is made for hardware engineers and hackers like me who want to use electronics markets to source parts but struggle with a language barrier. Everything is presented in a point-to-translate format, so you don't need to know anything about written or spoken Chinese to use it. Most of the guide is dedicated to things like components, tooling, and how to negotiate with vendors. The guide also helps you get to and from the markets and includes a few survival phrases to help you out in a pinch. Its detailed treatment of the electronics market is a perfect complement to general travel guides. The guide covers everything from diodes and displays to injection molding and pricing. It's everything you need to find, evaluate, and purchase parts in the Shenzhen electronics market. There are also multiple copies of tear-out maps and ample space for note-taking so you can remember the locations of vendors and share your findings with friends.
Thanks, and happy hacking!
Okay, and I would say this is a successful Crowd Supply because we received
ours today. Yeah.
Yeah, that's how you know.
Yeah, I got 2 books, so we have one, maybe we'll give away one. And
let's save it for Ask an Engineer next
week. Maybe tune in, people. Yeah. Ask an Engineer, maybe we'll give away this book. Of course, you can still get it on the Crowd Supply site. That's actually one of the nice things about Crowd Supply is they also fulfill... after the crowdfunding is complete.
Yeah, so I'm going to go.
Let's go to the computer.
Yeah.
So this is Crowd Supply, yay! And they raised almost $55,000, 1,600 pledges, probably about, doesn't really say how many got of each, but probably about 2,000 books total. I think a lot of people got 2 books. I did.
Yeah, me too.
And each book is about $35. You can get 2 for $60. You can see that video there, and you can still pick one up. So go to Crowd Supply and search for Bunny or Shenzhen, and you'll, because his URL is quite long, and then pick up one of these books if you like it. Bunny is the expert who can bridge both the maker world, the maker pro world, engineering, manufacturing, and of course also speaks Mandarin, and so. He's like the perfect person to do this because he's been visiting Shenzhen. He's probably lived in Shenzhen. He's done multiple large scale product manufacturing things from robots to devices that have made it into Best Buy to maker projects to, he's just consulted on a whole bunch of stuff. So, high praise, but also high promise.
And also, Bunny's managed to keep his values of open source. And his quest for our digital freedoms no matter what he's done.
Yep. From hacking the Xbox and...
Yeah, he got an EFF Pioneer Award. He did some neat stuff with HDMI.
Yeah, doing fun HDMI hacking. All sorts of really cool stuff. He's one of my idols, so
yeah, do you want to show this book over on the overhead? All right, let's get to it. All right, look at this.
Okay, so this is the cover, and it's got this cool gold leaf. So it's Enig, which is good. It won't oxidize. And it's a really nice book. It's kind of meant to be like a, you know, it has pronunciation and text, but it's also meant for people to point at when you have questions or you want like clarification about something. So it's, it's got this, I think, really nice rubber band to keep it closed, but it also has the binding that is, you know, perfectly flat binding. It's a little, you know, bulky, but not too much. So very nice binding. And then... kind of a nice textured top. And then there's tabs.
It lays flat.
It does a lay flat. And then there's tabs for each section. So in the introduction, you know, it talks about, you know, how to pronounce words and like how to go and basic details of like how to haggle. This is actually one of my favorite sections where he talks about fake. And he says, well, you know, if you have a flip phone with an Apple logo on it, is it fake? And he says, well, in Shenzhen, in Chinese philosophy, it's no more fake than a person wearing a cat outfit. Like, if somebody's wearing cat ears, you don't think they're a fake cat. They're a person wearing cat ears. Likewise, you know, if you have a product with an Apple logo on it, it's just wearing an Apple logo. Of course, it's not a real Apple product. So it's just like a, you know, a trade dress. So I thought that was kind of funny. And he also talks about, a lot of the things that you don't know that can bite you, and having purchased a lot of things from China, these are really important to understand. You know, you're going to get samples that are perfect, and the quality is going to degrade. You're going to get motors with certain specs or batteries with certain specs. You have to test those specs. Just because something is printed on it doesn't mean it's true. I've gotten wires that say 22 gauge, and when you actually measure them, they're 28. And you say, like, well, why is this 28 gauge? The cable says 20 or 22 gauge on it. And the seller will be like, oh, it's like Chinese gauge. It's slightly different. Okay, yeah, whatever. You have to constantly verify and do QC procedures and never relent on them. Everything has to be tested because things will be changed on you to make it less expensive. So there's some of the things you have to watch out for. And it's just, you'll just have to learn from experience and get a feeling for what is the thing that's likely to degrade. You know, you're buying LEDs, you spec them to be 5,000 millicandela, you'll find, you know, the first shipment is 5,000. By the third shipment, you're maybe getting 3,000 or something. And if you don't tell them, hey, you know, check this out, or, you know, you have to test and verify, then you're not going to get what you paid for. And so he talks about some, you know, things to watch out for, you know, date codes, prototypes, brands, just watch out. Brand markings mean nothing. You have to test something fully. When you buy memory, make sure you verify that the memory is the amount you think it is. Part markings don't mean anything if you're buying from the market and you're not getting them from an authorized distributor. It talks about going on the internet. And then, so this is actually the meat of the book. So that's, you know, of course, great stuff. This is where people are going to really like using it. It's the point to translate, which is kind of like a lot of books that I've used where when you're traveling, instead of just giving you a phrase book, which is just like words and words, they actually give you the word in, you know, English and then the word in Mandarin. And then the person can point to it or you can point to it. And so you have sort of a thing that you can say, you know, what is this resistor? And they'll say, oh, metal film, and they'll point to it so that, you know, they read, oh, Jinshu Bo, and they'll, instead of you having to try to translate what that means, they'll just point to metal film. So this is the page just about resistors. So, you know, all of the different Temcos and mounting style, and, you know, I like this. He has cheapest and finest in general use, what's in stock, anything is okay. This is like stuff I say all the time when purchasing stuff. Sometimes you're like, I want the highest quality battery, but for jelly bean components for resistors, it might be like, look, anything, even 10% resistor is fine. I just need a pull-up of, you know, about 10K. And so you'll need to, watch when you want one or the other. You know, is the wattage really important? You want to make sure that that is of, you know, the finest quality quarter watt if the wattage is important. Otherwise, you're going to get, you know, tenth of a watt or less. Capacitors. And you can talk about ESR and range and brands and different styles. So it's kind of nice. Voltages. You know, different aluminum or tantalum or mica, so when you, when you're purchasing capacitors. LEDs. So this is a common thing. You know, buying LEDs from China, LEDs are LEDs, so if they have something that looks close to what you want, you're probably going to be good to go. Anode, cathode, flashing. This is kind of funny. These are the those flashing LEDs for throwies and stuff, probably. Different colors, casings. And then if you're buying surface mount parts, there's imperial and metric. So what we often call 0603, they might call 1608. And this can get confusing because, for example, 01005 imperial is metric, the same as 0402. I think that's not, it's one of the few ones that actually like totally has the same numbering, so you have to watch out for that. Like 1206, it never quite lines up with that, so you have to watch out that this is the one that I've gotten not bit by, but I've been confused. I think when we bought the Samsung, it was spec'd in imperial, but we thought it was metric. So they were like, oh, it can do as small as, you know, 1005. And I thought, well, is that metric or imperial? Because Samsung is a South Korean manufacturer. And then, so that's something to watch out for. I think almost everybody goes by imperial. I mean, of course, you can also look at it. Inductors. Yeah, this is definitely one you want to make sure, because usually inductors are purchased for either RF or for power supplies. Make sure you get the right kind, the right current, the right frequency, material, and of course filtering, because you can get RF noise from your inductors. Different kinds of diodes. Tell them what kind of reverse leakage you want. Package, voltage, LED type, Schottky, germanium. You know, some, I like this, like similar is okay or exact match. Sometimes you're like, well, any 20 volt shock here. Sometimes you're like, look, I really want an MB120, and you got to get me that exact part. Transistors. Wow, MOSFET is like ridiculous. Or maybe this is multiple different names. Or maybe this is actually metal oxide semiconductor, field effect transistor. Maybe they actually spell it out, because this is the symbol for metal. So that, yeah, MOSFET. That's kind of a ridiculous thing. I think they would have an acronym. Dual N-channel, P-channel, BJTs, let's see, connectors. Oh, all sorts of connectors. This is, you know, never ends. See, don't see ZIF here, but I guess you could probably type out ZIF and they'd probably say like, oh, I know what that means. Micro USB. What I like most is if you use like Chrome to translate Chinese, micro USB always gets translated as Andrews. So it's always like, Andrews connect. And I'm like, what? Why is Andrew involved in this? And it's just the same word for micro USB is the same as Andrew, I guess. Or the same symbols. Okay, so pitches and diameter. So I like this, all these different connectors. Now that's kind of cool. These are different resolutions for displays. Displays are like, you know, you want displays, you absolutely, China is like the best place to go. Everything's made there and you can get anything. You know, oftentimes you're getting secondary stock, but they'll have tens of thousands, and that might be good enough for you. I think, you know, nowadays I actually get displays custom made, but when we first started Adafruit, I would get secondary stock, which was frustrating because every time I ordered, I'd get something different. But once you're ordering more than 10,000 at a time, you can get custom made. And then, you know, the panels are actually made, the glass, they're often referred to as glass, they're made by only a couple different companies. So even though the module might be made by like a, you know, Display Corp, they're going to use Sharp or BOE or AUO panels, and you'll see them mention this. Like I recently got some TFTs and they said, oh yeah, we're changing from, I think it was like Handstar to BOE. So that's the makers of the the panel itself, because not everybody makes the actual display elements. I'd be more interested to find out more about how that whole system works. Get resolutions.
What's amazing to me is this is clearly years of telling someone that, or being part of the supply chain.
Everything?
This is probably more valuable than every single one of those accelerator.
Oh, yeah. So this is something I've
built hardware. Yeah. They take you to Shenzhen and they want to give you a tour. And then they're like, okay, like, there you go.
There's no class for this stuff.
Yeah. This like, is probably the most grade. Valuable thing I've seen for hardware manufacturers in the history. I mean, you're not going to get a Harvard MBA for manufacturing with anything even close to that.
Yeah, know? I've read a bunch of books about manufacturing in China, and what's funny is we do so much of display stuff at Adafruit, you know, the Pi TFTs and the breakouts and the OLEDs. I know, like, way too much about displays because I've just been, like, screwed over so many times. Well, not screwed over, but, like, I've had to deal with inconsistencies, quality issues, supply. It's just, like, a mess. And it's just funny. It's just, like, you know, this... pattern generator is funny because I know I have a couple panel generators that I purchased from vendors because you know you can buy the panel generators as well because it's like we have to test the TFTs and they have these like nice clamps, you know cap touch or resistive or make or model and the grade. I've come across this when you buy TFTs. You know some of the TFTs that we buy are pulled. Like for example, the Nokia 5100. LCDs, like we warn people, these are not made anymore. Any displays that you see have been pulled from phones. When people recycle electronics, what do you think happens to those recycled parts? They get pushed back into the Chinese and Taiwanese supply chain.
Every page is like, it could be
a story.
It could be an entire book. And, you know, I read all the maker businessy hardware business things and they're like, come up with a logo. Find your passion. It's like, oh my gosh. Like this is you actually need to know how the systems work, the words, the translations to know what characters to look for.
Yeah, this is if you're buying a. And what's interesting is if you don't say you want a thing, you're not gonna get the thing. Do you know what I mean? Like it's like the you have to know what you're not getting, because and it's not a malicious thing, but if you don't ask for a specific thing, like what you didn't ask is what you're not gonna get, and you don't know that that's what you're gonna get until you realize that you didn't get what you wanted. And it's sometimes it seems ridiculous because I think Americans have a certain expectation. Like, oh, I expect that, you know, when I, like, for example, like, let's say you're buying, like, this is a computer parts thing. Let's say you're buying a tablet. If you buy a tablet from China, you know, you'll, especially if you're, like, wholesaling, you'll have to specify exactly what processor, how much RAM, and you have to specify it must be able to run Android 4.4. If you don't specify that it has to be able to run Android 4.4, they'll sell you something that can only run Android 3. Because it's like, well, you wanted the cheapest thing. So it's like, we're going to sell you the cheapest thing, which is not going to be able to run the latest version of the operating system. It's not at all malicious. It's just, well, you didn't specify the thing that you wanted. That's just an example. I mean, there's like thousands of things. If you don't specify the wire gauge, you can get a power connector, and the power connector is spec'd for 10 amps, but the wire isn't. But if you don't ask for the wire to be spec'd, they're not going to get it. If you don't ask for like, a specific thing, you're just not, it's not guaranteed for you. You know, if you don't specify IPS, you're not going to get IPS. You have to pay for that. So this is also a list of all the things that you'll want to check for and make sure that you get. Like, if you want cap touch or resistive, you have to specify. You just can't say, like, touch screen. You're going to get the cheapest thing possible, which is going to be resistive, even though nowadays in America, everything that's touch screen is capacitive. Anyways, it's just my rant about... dealing. Computer parts. Importing computers into China is very difficult. You have to build a test jig or you have to buy a computer. It's going to be difficult to import it, especially if you want to leave it there for your manufacturing. So you might have to build your own. Just be aware of that. It's where a Raspberry Pi might come in handy because they're really small. They don't look like a computer. Tools. You're probably going to have to buy tools. All sorts of tools available. Protection circuits and power strips and battery chargers. And of course, verify the things when you get them. And, you know, the if you don't pay for it, you're not going to get something that good. You know, the desoldering braid is not, if you want the cheapest, you're not going to get the really nice oxidation-free versions, you're going to get the cheap stuff. And if you don't ask for lead-free, you're going to get it with lead, because they don't care about Rojas. It's cheaper to do and sell lead. So this is actually kind of smart. And it's about managing expectations, I think, that the more that if you're going to Shenzhen, going there, you know, sometimes I read rants by people who are like, oh, I went to manufacture in China and I got totally ripped off and like they screwed me over. And it's like, well, no, you had really bad expectations. You didn't manage those expectations. So it's one of the things about doing Maker Pro you just got to watch out for. Okay, tools. Pentalobular. So if yours is an iPhone, you know, the pentalobe.
I feel like Bunny's going to just start speaking in page numbers because everyone asked them the same questions probably for the last 10 years. You can be like,
page 49. And it's showing pretty well, yeah. Switches and push buttons.
Yeah.
Actually, I see this. I like this symbol a lot. I use this.
Switch,
a, yeah. Yeah, because I use this a lot when I'm searching for
I
things.
I like the electrics, the electric head.
Yeah.
Electric brain, computer.
Yeah. Oh, right. Let's look at my electric brain. I'm trying to remember how to. Under tools, computer. You know, it's funny for CPU, central, and this is like the middle.
Yeah.
This means middle, so it's like a central thing. I don't think they have computer. Yeah, electric.
Yeah.
Electronic, diagonal. Another thing that I remember reading once is inches is different. There's like Chinese inch, like it's thumb, and then there's American inch, which is different, so there's another thing to watch out for. Like you'd think like inch is inch, but apparently it's not. Okay, materials and finishings. What kind you want? All things are possible. You want aluminum parts or lead-free, or gold, silver, platinum, wood, fiberglass. Injection molding. This I would be scared to do without somebody on hand, but if you want to, you know, if you go to a house that does injection molding, you know, they'll look at what you're building. And when we do our injection molding, we actually send them Raspberry Pi. We send them multiple Raspberry Pis and all the cables that would plug into it. And because we have a injection molding house that's that we've worked with, you know, we're partners with them. They know what we want, so we're like, okay, the snap fits in. They understand, like, oh, this is supposed to snap fit.
Yeah.
Something that, you know, if you don't ask for, if you don't clarify, yes, this is supposed to snap closed, you might not get that. Again, it's what's not said that leads to disappointment. This is kind of cool. So this is, you know, you can get samples, and you'll often get a sample, but you'll want something different. And we do this sometimes. We'll get a connector or a part or an adapter, and we'll say, okay, well, you know, this part's pretty close, but we want it, you know, maybe surface mount, or we want it, I guess, surface mount signal wires and through-hole mounting feet. So this is, you know, if you want a mixed part. This is something I ask a lot. A lot of parts in China come in bulk. They hand place a lot of stuff. It's often cheaper to hire someone to hand place, especially for connectors or some odd sensors or parts. So if you want something in a tray or reel, reel is kind of difficult sometimes, you know, to get, but you can ask for it. This one is one that it's a little weird. What's self-blinking? Like what? What sample did Bunny get that was self-blinking?
Bunny, what let you down to make it? I just don't need self-blinking. I'm going to put this in a book.
Oftentimes, you can get things with 110 volts. Like, I got this projector that we're going to take apart, maybe in the next show. And, you know, I always ask, you know, with a US plug for 110 volt. And it's rarely a problem, even though China is 220. Almost everything is made that you can use as figure eight plug or, you know, IEC.
Yep.
Packaging. This is, again, it's important. You know, if you want desiccant or ESD, you got to ask for it. You know, sometimes you have to ask something as basic as, like, hey, can you make it so, like, it doesn't, like, get crushed and destroyed on the way over to me?
Yeah, I like the last line. It's not possible.
It is not possible. You know, but they'll be honest. Like, if it's, sometimes it'll take a while. You know, there'll be a long lead time. You know, asking what the lead time is, it's important.
Well, you know, the other thing is there's a bunch of, and I'm going to say this because I know it's true because we get these emails. There's a lot of people who have these successful Kickstarters and they email us and, you know, all the renderings are like Apple Store packaging. And I'm sure people are getting like manufacturers and they're just like, hey, like we wanted to make it look like the Apple packaging. And I'm sure it's just like, it's not possible.
It's not possible.
You have to get like a million of these before you could do that.
So. No inventory. This happens a lot. So like, you know, we're trying to get these like these dot star LEDs in a 2020 package, a 2mm by 2mm. And like we got some, but then we're like, okay, we're ready to order. Like the sample's good. Like send us tape and reel. And they came back and they said there's no inventory. And we're like, okay, like can we order and get, it'll come back later, and they're like, it will take a while. So they have like yield issues. So that's something that, you know, can come up as well. This is a famous line that Ian Lesnett always talks about, make a handle out of tape. Calls us the harmony.
Yeah.
Line. I have to look it up, but you know, you can take stuff and they'll make a tape handle for you. I guess it's a cultural thing. This is really important, you know, if you want things vacuum sealed or ESD. There's a lot of, you know, I've had issues with like NeoPixel yield, for example. The first batch was really great, but then the later batches had yield issues when pick and placing. You know, you have to have just a perfect heating curve. And, you know, so getting an ESD bag with desiccant, you know, we have to ask them, like, hey, make sure you put plenty of desiccant in there. Mm. So one thing I will say that, you know, is, again, it's counter to, like, a lot of people's, you know, the thing, people who say have, like, really bad experiences and they're like, oh, I was lied to. I've noticed something that if you don't ask for something and you're not going to get it, but if you ask a question, I've almost never been, like, lied to or like, given the incorrect answer. So, like, you know, asking, is this refurbished or new stock? If you don't ask, you're going to get refurbished. But if you ask, they'll say, oh, this is refurbished. Like, if you know to ask this question, then you'll get the answer. If you don't ask it, then they're going to give you whichever is most convenient. Are you the manufacturer is sometimes a tougher one because they'll not say no, but they'll say, well, we're, you know, the partner to the manufacturer. We have an exclusive deal. There'll be a little bit of a difficulty with that. I think they want to kind of hide that they're not necessarily the manufacturer. Or sometimes they'll say, this is a part number. And you'll say, well, is it really the part number? And they'll say, well, no, it's a compatible one. So it's, you know, again, something that you do have to, sometimes there'll be a presentation of them being a manufacturer. They'll say they are the factory. What they really mean is they are a broker for the factory, or they work with the factory. Or they're, you know, like there's a little bit of a communication difference. Like when we say manufacturer, we mean like you actually make the thing, whereas they might think manufacturer is more like I'm the OEM. That's some experience I've had. But if you ask for new or refurbished, they'll just tell you the truth. And with the MOQ, important to ask, don't, you know, if you get samples, you can always get samples, but, you know, expect the MOQ to be a couple hundred to 1,000. And, you know, so far I've always been able to get samples. Sometimes I pay for samples and then I get the MOQ. Sometimes I ask for the MOQ before the sample. Sometimes for the first order, you can get them to adapt the MOQ, and sometimes you can say, okay, look, you know, the MOQ is 10,000. I'll tell you what, I'll order 1,000 the first time. And you say, like, for good business development, and I will order more, and then I'll order. So if you,
what does MOQ stand for people who've never even heard of
minimum order quantity? But again, it's adaptable. Sometimes if there's a setup fee, if you pay for the setup fee, the MOQ will be lower. Sometimes if there's a lot of customization, the MOQ is going to be a lot higher. The MOQ may change over time, in which case you want to make sure you have another supply. I've had companies where I've ordered 500 at a time and they're perfectly happy, and then eventually they come back and say, look, you know, we don't want to make this part anymore. MOQ is now 5,000. I'll say, look, let me order another 1,000 and I'll find another supplier so that, you know, I can get out of here. Or I'll say, okay, what if I order, you know, 5,000 but split over multiple different colors, like for LEDs? Or what if I promise to order 5,000 but, you know, in a year's worth, not all at once? So you just have to kind of like, you can be a little flexible with the MOQ stuff. Like, don't be a dick. Don't like promise to buy and then like not. Like, you know, if the quality is what you expect to say, like, look, if the quality is good, I'll buy more. And I've always been true to my word. If the quality was what I expected, I would place more purchase orders. But that's something where you can sometimes do a little bit of adaptation.
Okay.
And then, of course, there's price differences. Like, again, if you buy less than MOQ, you might say, hey, look, I'll pay 25% more if I get a smaller MOQ or something. So this is where you actually go and you're at the event and or that the...
It's interesting that WeChat is used so much that that is a term that you use.
WeChat?
What is your WeChat?
What's your QQ?
Yeah.
I don't QQ, but our purchasing manager sometimes does because, again, there's no... It's fun to try to transfer files. You can do a lot of file transfer as attachments, but you know, they don't have Dropbox. But they do have Microsoft
Yeah, you can use
Drive.
Yeah.
Like, so it's like you have to kind of figure out like what's your system for, you know, sometimes like it's hard to send mail. Like you'll have to deal with firewall stuff at some point.
Yeah.
You know, and a lot of times they're aware that there's like, if you have a video, you can't send a YouTube link, like they can't get to YouTube.
Yeah, we use Vimeo.
So what we do is we use Vimeo and then we sometimes take that file and transfer it to, you know, one of the other services. But like if I want to show them like, hey, here's how this thing is supposed to work, like I'll do a video demo. Just be aware you can't send a YouTube link. And you can't attach a file either because it's like way too big. So, you have to be a little bit flexible.
Yeah. It's a lot of adaptation. You know, one of the things, I'll just rant a little bit, is I think there's a tendency for very new hardware makers, and I'm going to pick on the failed Kickstarters a little bit.
Wow, geez, this is...
Because we just, you know, they email us like, oh, nothing worked out. Could Adafruit make stuff for us? And the thing that I've noticed is there's a tendency for first-time hardware makers to blame everyone else. They didn't invest in figuring out the supply chain. They didn't invest in learning anything about the culture that of the people that they're going to work with. They didn't invest any time to understand that you can't just send it over Dropbox or get an Uber there. Like, there's so many things that you have to be... It's not just like, oh, and this is what I've heard, and I actually don't like when I hear this, is like, oh, China's just going to do it. It's like, no, like, people are going to do it. And
there's people
that,
yeah.
Yeah, and so you can't just say that and do that. And I think this book that Bunny did shows that if you're willing to work hard and smart with a global supply chain, it's possible. And if you're not, there's only one person to blame. It's you. And we've seen this before. My supplier didn't work out. Well, like, you didn't do all the things that everyone says you should always do to make sure you're communicating well.
There's people who send stuff out to, like, you know, for example, like, you know, if you're getting manufacturing gen in China and you don't send a really, really strict, good quality test jig with procedural instructions and you pay for testing, you have to pay extra to get testing done, you kind of have only yourself to blame. I mean, if they don't follow the testing procedure and you paid for it, you know, that's a different thing. And, you know, that does happen sometimes, but you there's a lot of, again, it's what you don't know that you're supposed to ask that you didn't know because you've never been in the situation where you didn't ask the right question, if that makes sense. And also data sheets like aren't always true. Like I've purchased displays from China with parts where the data sheet said it could do a certain interface and then when I used it, it couldn't. And then when like I finally trickle up to like, you know, the senior engineer, they're like, well, you're right, this data sheet's wrong. Sorry, like we sold you this display and it said it could do, you know, 4-wire SPI and it can't. Sorry. And I'm like, okay, great. Well, let's find another chipset that can. There's just so many things that can go wrong at so many levels. And it's kind of, you know, like the stories about people who are like day trading. Like, yeah, technically you can go in and trade on the market against, you know, massive companies, but you don't even know what you don't know. And it can be very dangerous. So don't go alone, you know, and just be aware of that. I think, you know, going and taking a tour with Bunny or going to a hardware incubator helps, but
I think reading this book, even though it's a guide cover to cover, if this sounds interesting, like a giant puzzle you can decipher and adapt, and then like this is your map for this video game, if that's exciting to you, maybe hardware manufacturing is for you. But yeah. don't wait and figure this out after you get the $1 million Kickstarter.
Well, hopefully the people would actually be going to Shenzhen. If they're going to be manufacturing, you should go to Shenzhen and be there on the line while it's made. Like, you can't just send it and get 10,000 pieces back.
The next time I talk to either a crowdsource person who wants to do a crowdsource thing or one of the crowdsourcing companies, I might suggest that this book is mandatory. Like, you can't post your Kickstarter until it's pretty clear that you read this book.
Yeah.
Because, like, at least you know what you're in for. Especially if you're going to manufacture not in your living room like we used to, or in your factory in New York like we have.
Yeah.
Okay, next up.
Okay, so then this next chapter is about like getting around and doing stuff. So this is like how to take a taxi. So I think that there's enough foreigners in that area that they probably probably don't, you know, charge you too much, you know, as long as it's an official taxi. There's a metro, so you can take the metro. SIM card, this is really important. When you get there, you'll want to get a SIM card for your phone. Make sure you have a phone that can take a SIM. Of course, you can buy a phone at the Seg Market, but you should probably bring one so you know it works for sure. Get a SIM card. Well, I'm sure there's thousands of stalls in Shenzhen for people going from Hong Kong to Shenzhen to pick up a SIM card. And then this is funny. Can you unlock my phone? I'm sure there's like a whole stall and people are just like, yeah, sure. Like,
yes, it is possible.
Yeah. So, if you can pick up a cheap unlocked phone, that's probably a good idea.
Sims. That's cool.
Topping off your Sims. And they talk about how to do that and how to manage it.
That's like, if you're doing a hardware project and you're getting this far, you know, you're going to save a lot of time. Like, you don't want to be figuring out phone stuff. You want to be meeting with the partners and the people that you're going to do stuff with. You don't want to just be like figuring out how to get a SIM card.
Yeah. It's kind of fun going spicy food, eating stuff. He does talk a little bit about, you know, the food outside of the tourist areas. You're going to eat fun stuff.
Yeah.
Fun street food. So just be aware of that. Squat toilets and toilet paper. That's something that when we went to Tokyo, we noticed there weren't a lot of places didn't have Western toilets and there was no toilet paper. You have to have your own with you.
Yeah.
That's like, you know, you're expected to carry your own. But there were people, you know, giving away the napkins, tissue on the street with advertisements. So that was kind of handy. So you'd grab one of those before you went to the bathroom. I don't think they'll probably have that in Shenzhen. So bring some, you know, bring a napkin. You know, those little tissue packets. Yeah. Grab a bunch of those and bring them with you. And also some soap. That's another thing. There's no soap. Yeah. You just bring your own soap.
Yep. All
right. Use your left hand. Okay.
All right.
Money. Cash or card. So I guess you have to do everything in cash.
A lot of it's cash, yeah.
They don't have civil forfeiture, funny. Yeah, everything's in cash, and so there's no ATMs. I guess people just they just deal everything with cash. So just be aware of that. Maybe getting your money changed at the hotel or at the airport or before you leave if you can manage it. Okay, and then how to get there. I know that this is always a little bit fun because you have to get a visa. So... yeah, you need to get a visa. Don't try to get one on arrival. So get it ahead of time, and you can get a 10-year visa because you might as well, right? If you go twice, it's probably worth it.
Mm-hmm.
So you get a tourist visa. It's funny, even purchasing stuff counts as tourist visa. And then a lot of people go to Hong Kong airport, and then they go take the ferry across. Which sounds probably wise, because that way you always have a home base in Hong Kong. You're not staying in Shenzhen. And then here's all the different border crossings. Wow, this is kind of cool. There's like a, all the different ways you can do it, like Hong Kong taxi or bus or airport van, and different places, and you can go over by foot. So he likes to take the Fujian border. And then I guess on the other side, you just take a another taxi. Are there any questions? Because this is, we're getting into like the super texty.
Oh, just keep going.
Okay, I mean, so
just,
passport tips.
Buzz through the last parts. And
This is just how to get to the border, how to get to the airport. And then these are some maps. This is kind of fun. So maps of Hua Ching District. I think that's how you say it. So how to get around. So there's a metro, and there's like a couple different exits. So I think, the way he suggests doing it is he's got these pages, and there's multiple pages that are all the same. And so if you like a vendor and you want to get back to that vendor, you want to share it with your friend, ask them where are they, and so that they can get back to you, or like write down the location, because I guess it's really difficult to figure out how to get back to the stall. And once they mark it, then you can visit it again. And he also has these nice plastic pieces. So this is a business card. So you can put the business card of the vendor. And I've actually received business cards with samples and stuff. They usually have the QQ number, the website, the email address, which is almost always like an individual's, like, not you, Yahoo or Gmail, but it'll be like an individual, like Hotmail address or something. Like it's surprisingly normal for, you'll be dealing with a multi-million-dollar company, like a company that you might be doing tens of thousands of dollars of business with, and you'll be dealing with someone named Annie, and she's using her personal Hotmail address or AOL account to talk to you. It's just kind of how it is. And then I guess there's this larger pocket here, which you can maybe put samples in or pieces of paper. I don't know exactly what. Let's see if it says what it's for. It doesn't really say. And so this is the different entrances. Okay, so there's all these different zones. So there's electronic components, batteries, power banks, flash memory in one zone, smart wearables in another zone, like watches and health monitors, surveillance gears, cameras. 6F is shipping alley, so this is like how you can do the shipping management if you're buying a lot and you'll want to aggregate the shipment, or get a DHL or freight shipping. So one of the things is they often will take it to Hong Kong and ship from there, or they'll aggregate. There's so many systems to shipping. It's nothing simple. Nothing is simple about shipping from China. There's a Starbucks. LED, international LED market. That sounds like fun. Probably a lot of LED strips and pixels and stuff, signs. Laptops, laptop parts, soldering irons, rework, test equipment. LCD panels from 7-inch to 50-inch. So third and fourth floors. Wow. That's kind of cool. Check that out. There's the Hacks Accelerator. So I guess that's the accelerator that Seed is part of. And then the Shanghai Hotel. So that's a good place you can stay. There's a McDonald's, mobile phone and parts market over here. Spare parts for phones, from LCD screens to microprocessors. They can repair them. And then recycling. And so this is 9A is where all those phones are taken apart. So you'll see people probably pulling flash and reballing BGAs, and then just removing elastomers or batteries, and then recycling it into something. A lot of the times is the phones are being thrown out, the batteries might be okay. Okay, so there's a fashion mall, so you can actually go get some clothing. Commodity exchange for mobile phones. Oh, so this is like spot prices for stuff. So this is interesting. There's like, they just confiscate memory cards, I guess. So you're not allowed to take photos. So every day there's like spot prices for things. Like, we buy a lot of SD cards here at Adafruit. We buy like tens of thousands of SD cards because we package them with pies, and also people buy them for all sorts of projects. And the price of a flash, the price of an SD card is, it's basically just flash memory. So whatever the spot price of flash is, that's what you're going to be paying. And so you actually want to watch the market. And sometimes it's very, very high for some reason, you know, a factory closed down or there's yield issues or whatever. And sometimes the price is very low. And so you want to, of course, buy when it's low. And sometimes the prices will be weird. Like sometimes 8 gig and 16 gig will be the same price. And sometimes 4 gig will be higher than 8. Like it really depends on the demand. But because it's so commoditized, there are some components that you might be paying and in which they're so commoditized and they're somewhat expensive, like flash or maybe certain processors or memory, you'll be paying whatever the going rate is. Because again, it doesn't matter who makes the actual flash chip itself, right? You can get a Samsung card, but the company making the flash inside of it could vary from card to card. Shenzhai phones, tablets, Android TV. Chinese tablets and phones are all Android. Like if they love Android. Everything I get is like, they'll just put Android. We got these DLP projectors, they're all Android. Like, there's really no reason for them to run an operating system, but they do. And then these are those removable cards. So yeah, I think maybe you'd put your samples in here and then a business card. And so you get like 20 of these pages. That's kind of handy. And then I guess you can put notes on the back as well, because back is blank. So that's kind of nice. And then acknowledgments to Celia Wang for helping with Translate. And that's it, 123 pages. Epic.
Okay. And that is it.
Yeah. So I really do want to visit Shenzhen sometime. So maybe this will inspire us to go.
Yeah, I want to go further than 14 blocks from work or apartment. I mean, like, that's kind of...
Above 60th and then Shenzhen.
Yeah. I mean, it's just like we're really busy.
I know.
But I feel like this is one of those things where so many people are going to get helped, and we get asked about stuff and we don't know about it. Now we have a place to point people. So I feel like this is a good thing.
I know. You know, a lot of times, you know, people will... use like Alibaba or AliExpress, which is okay. You can get pretty far just by using that, but it is, you are not going to get as good quality or as good, you're kind of buying whatever's available. The most important thing is if you're buying from China, if you can go there, of course, it's the best option. If not, try to get someone who will be a broker for you, someone who will be the middleman or middlewoman to negotiate pricing and handle the shipping. Because otherwise it can get very difficult and complicated. And also, that, you know, somebody who knows the kind of stuff you want, they'll be able to understand the quantities you're purchasing, the quality you're looking for, the kind of lead times you expect. Somebody who can translate for you, somebody in that market. Maybe there's a stall that, you know, at the market there where you can find somebody. There should be. That'd be really cool if there was like a basically rent a translator, like rent a experienced person, if you don't have this book. Yeah. That'd be kind of useful.
Yeah, I mean, this is one of the most interesting things to come out of the maker world for people who want to be...
This is awesome.
Maker to market.
Yeah, if you have anything to do,
Pro, yeah.
Even if you're not going to Shenzhen, even if you're just purchasing components that come from China, which chances are you are, this is a really great resource. Because oftentimes you're going to read data sheets or emails or specs and they're going to be in Chinese. This is very handy to see. It might be also really neat to, if a PDF of this is released, to be able to copy and paste the phrases. So if you have to send an email, you can use that as well.
Yeah.
Because sometimes the English isn't so good for the people who do email.
Yeah. I hope this works out. We'll talk to Bunny next time. We talk to Bunny, and we'll ask if we can purchase a bunch of these to sell them in the Adafruit store. I'd like to have it for no other reason than to signal everyone, like, this is... something that we really like. I think this video is a start, but when we see him next, we'll ask and see what's happening.
Yeah.
What's possible? And if he could just point to the page and say not possible or possible.
Not possible. It will take a long time. Okay, well, I hope everybody enjoyed that review. I had a lot of fun going through this book. This was my first time going through it.
Good work,
I think this is awesome. I know almost nothing about Shenzhen, so I'm I feel a little smarter just having read this. And of course, Bunny is an expert and trusted.
Yeah.
I feel like maker and engineer.
Even if you're doing a lot of correspondence over email or video chats, or you're working with a factory partner, I think this helps have some insights into their world. And anytime you can be a better communicator with a partner who's all the way in another country while you're trying to work on something very complex like hardware, can always be beneficial.
Yeah. So go out and support Bunny and purchase a copy of this book. I don't know when the next printing is going to ship. Also, check out his blog and the updates on CrowdSupply, because he's talked a lot about the process of making this, and also some things he learned about book printing that he didn't know he was supposed to ask about, you know, variation and like, oh, I, you know,
yeah.
Again, it's fun to watch him be like, okay, you know, I know the things to ask and check for with electronic parts, but I'm learning all the things you have to ask and check for when printing a book.
Yeah. And
make the pages not dissolve.
Yeah. And then I did have a couple last things here.
Uh-huh.
So here's some photos that were on the blog.
Yeah.
Or the updates. And you can see how it's printed out and the plate. And then...
yeah, this is the plate. He designed it in the Altium.
And then here's Bunny. And I believe this is one of the factory managers.
Yeah, so, printing the first book.
Yeah, good stuff. And...
this is the second best thing to having Bunny by your side. I would like to go to Shenzhen with Bunny.
Yeah. All right. Well, thanks, everyone. We'll have some probably other broadcasts over the weekend, maybe, and, of course, Ask an Engineer next week. And Epic Week, thank you, everyone out there. Dust of Lady is supported by you, the customer. We don't have loans or venture capital. We are supported by you. So if you like... Lady Ada's version of the Oprah Book Club. this is one, go to CrowdSupply and pick up this book from Bunny, of course.
Of course.
But if you want any electronics made by us at Adafruit here in New York City, go to adafruit.com.
You know, it's funny, is I have to, right after this, I have to do a video for our LCE supplier, because the sample of the TFT I got was perfect and the 1,000 I got have a connector that's loose. So maybe
yeah.
I'll grab some phrases from here.
Okay.
Like, hey, could you fix this? I ordered 1,000 and they're not exactly what I thought they were.
Yeah.
That's my life.
Not right. Possible.
It will take a long time.
Yeah.
All right. Everybody.
Where is the taxi? Okay. Bye, everybody.
Take me to the Seg Market.
Yeah.